Welcome, this is Unit 12 of the Expert Track. This unit is at the heart of this MOOC, as it will provide more hands-on learning and skill building in this topic. With practical guidelines on each tool that you will need for your final assignment, we haven't spoken a lot about it yet, but you may want to start thinking about how you will go about your assignment as you go through this chapter, as it will bring all or most of the tools together in the end. This unit will focus on practical ways of integrating ecosystems in risk, hazard, and vulnerability assessments. Here are our learning questions. First, what are risk, hazard, and vulnerability assessments, and why do we need them? Second, what are the most common approaches to assessing vulnerability, hazards, and risk, and how can we integrate ecosystems in these assessments? Let's first quickly revise the concept risk. Do you remember that risk refers to potential losses and is composed of three main elements: hazards, vulnerability, and exposure? Well, at least this is the most common definition given by UNISDR and the one we will use in this course. If this seems unfamiliar, we recommend you go back and take another look at Unit 2, especially the background reading materials. The basic idea behind establishing a risk assessment is that we want to reduce the likelihood of future damages and suffering due to hazard events. This is why one of the first steps in establishing an integrated risk management plan is to assess the risks or potential losses to a population over time. We then want to communicate these risks and take the appropriate measures to reduce them. We often communicate risk through geographic information systems, or GIS maps, although there may be many other ways of communicating about immediate or pending risks, depending on cultural norms, such as through oral history, songs, or street theater. So our second question is, what are the most common approaches to assessing vulnerability, hazards, and risk, and how can we integrate ecosystems in these assessments? So depending on your purpose, scope, budget, and time, there are many ways of developing a risk assessment. What we propose here is a simplified overview. So although you will not become risk assessment specialists, you will be able to understand the difference between vulnerability, hazard, and risk assessments, and how you can improve your assessments by integrating data on ecosystems. Let's go through the following four steps for conducting a risk assessment using our Green Island Map example. We can think of a risk assessment in terms of various layers. Let's start with vulnerability. Vulnerability is perhaps the most challenging to assess. To start with, natural or physical scientists assess it in different ways from social scientists. Social scientists working with NGOs usually combine the assessment of social vulnerability with capacities, or so-called vulnerability and capacity assessments. The data collected here are often very rich and qualitative, yet not always easy to translate into the kind of quantitative data needed for a risk assessment. For this, we tend to use socioeconomic data on income, education levels, household status. Natural or physical scientists might consider vulnerability to be the physical damage of a house or of a landscape to a certain hazard. Now, hazard assessments are usually more standardized than vulnerability assessments. Usually, we identify two types of data for hazards: the probability of an event reoccurring or its return period, and the intensity of the hazard. For these data, we need historical records as well as climate forecasts to the extent they exist for the area we are studying. Where several hazards are present, it is useful to develop a multi-hazard map, which provides a more comprehensive overview of all hazards. Since risk assessments require quite involved data collection and expertise, we often find that many NGOs and local governments focus on vulnerability and hazard assessments. But if we want to go for the complete risk assessment, the final piece of data we need is on exposure. Remember the UNISDR definition. Exposure refers to the number and the amount of time that people or infrastructure spend in a dangerous place. Data on exposure can be collected from satellite images, household surveys, or other population statistics. Finally, we come to the risk assessment, which usually takes the form of a risk map. The scale can be a neighborhood, a district, or even global, depending on your scope. A well-developed risk map will show areas at high, medium, to low risk, and will qualify what this means in terms of expected return periods of the hazard. As we have seen throughout this course, we know that the relative health or degradation of an ecosystem will especially affect the vulnerability component or magnitude of a hazard and thus overall risk. So adding one more layer of data on ecosystems can improve vulnerability, hazard, and risk assessments. Depending on what level of assessment you do, you can use qualitative data from communities on how well their ecosystems protect them from hazards. Or you can use more formal data on ecosystem services, usually collected through natural resources surveys. You should also include information on ecosystem health or degradation, which affects their protection or buffering functions against a certain hazard. We encourage you to read the background document of this unit, which takes you through an example from Jamaica, where ecosystem services were integrated in an assessment of coastal hazards. There are also several open source models that can be used for modeling the relationship between natural capital or ecosystem services and hazards. We will explore one example of this in the next unit. We will also discuss the importance of spatial data, GIS, and how to find data for combining ecosystem, hazard, and risk assessments. So stay tuned.